Well, it's okay. And then in the yard, and then in the summertime, we'd go out to playgrounds or someplace. In the cold weather, we'd go in the place we could get in out of the rain. It didn't matter. We didn't have a regular school for quite a while.
Right. How did the training differ from one period to the next?
It didn't differ.
Except when he opened his official school, though, right?
Up until he opened up a regular commercial school. It was just informal. And just a bunch of us guys that get together and work out. But when more guys started coming around, it got kind of loose, because a lot of guys would come around and see what he was doing, and they'd practice it for a few sessions, and then you wouldn't see him, and you know what I mean?
Right, okay.
Then,
what can you remember about...
There were a few guys that stayed, and they were, we all became, with the core group, we all became good friends, but there was a lot of guys that were kind of fringes,
Okay. We talked about his plans to open a chain of schools. Can you give me more details about that? What were his exact plans, or what you can remember?
No, he didn't give us any exact plans. He just said he wanted to open up a chain of schools. Spread the art all over the world, But he was not, he didn't sit down and give us an agenda.
Right.
Anything like that. He didn't tell us how to do it.
What was Bruce like while teaching as opposed to outside of class?
Well, when he was teaching us guys, he was all right. He just kept us going. And kept showing us the moves over and over. And actually, I don't think he liked teaching too much. He would get us going and then just have us do the moves over and over. And he'd just stand there and have us doing it. But he worked out with a couple of us. Actual working out along with us. He was way too far ahead of us to do as much good working out with us, but he did work out with us on chi-sao and on closing moves. He did a lot of stuff with a few guys, But when the group got bigger, he would just tell them what to do and stand there and have them do it, give some suggestions. I don't think he liked teaching a lot, but he did like to do chi-sao, and he did like to show closing moves, and he did like to practice against any kind of attack. He was always practicing against any kind of attack at all, and trying to find a weak spot. That's something that I do too. I keep looking for weak spots all the time. I'm always questioning.
Now, when the first school opened, do you have a lot back as far as, chi-sao and things like that, a lot of the stuff?
Yeah. I don't think he taught too much chi-sao after he started opening schools. Mm-hmm. He was given more complicated things. But the guy he worked out the most with was Jesse. He worked out with Jesse constantly. And if Jesse and I hadn't worked out together, I wouldn't have learned as much as I did, because I learned more from Jesse than I did from Bruce. In fact, any of that group who learned it well, or who even learned it halfway, learned more from Jesse than they did from Bruce, because Bruce wasn't that dedicated a teacher. But Bruce had shown me some moves, and then I practiced them with Jesse, and that's how I got to the point where I could do it.
You emphasize a lot of grappling now in your system of fighting. Is that the result of Bruce's lack of emphasis in the area?
He didn't have a lack of emphasis. He had a lot of respect for grappling. It's not the result of anything except that gung fu that we do, Paul, I don't know if you've ever seen the way we do the gung fu, but it ties right into grappling so well that you can be punching a guy and moving him around and go right into a grappling move without any waist motion at all, so that it plugs right into grappling. It's like seamless, you know what I mean? for a week at a time, and I work them on control moves, and I work them on some of the punching, too, so their punching gets a little more efficient, so they don't throw such wide punches, you know. But I also work them on control moves, and they like those control moves. They've written to me about it, they've told me about it, they told me how they work, and they're just amazed at how well the control moves work. Well, those control moves are they're good because you don't have to hurt the guy.
Right.
And if the guy gets too far out of control, you can revert to punching, or you can break his arm, or whatever you have to do. But the good thing about the control moves is that you don't have to hurt him. And a good bouncer does not want to hurt somebody.
Mm-hmm.
What he wants to do is either subdue the guy or get him out of the place, but not by damaging the guy in the process.
Right.
Oh, shit, that's someone's phone.
Another call?
Yeah, hold on. I'll get right back to you.
Okay.
Just hold on. Stay where you are.
Okay.
Tapes out of it. My students come to me and give me tapes they make of them. I don't have HD
then. So,
One good thing about the Gracies is that they can, they specialize in chokes and joint locks, which is very good.
Mm-hmm.
And they can get into a choke or a joint lock from almost any position. Mm-hmm. So it makes them extremely dangerous. They don't shoot in and do takedowns as smoothly as a wrestler, but they're adequate, you know. They're stuff they do is more like judo.
Do you think they'd be as successful if they were in an all-out street fight? Because, you know, the US, that tournament does have rules.
Yeah. I don't know. I think they do all right in most street fights, but they're not punchers.
Right.
They're not punchers at all, and if they learn how to punch right, they could probably be even better fighters, but they're pretty good fighters. And they're not somebody to laugh at.
Right.
In a fight with most street fighters, they just take down and probably choke them or something.
Yeah. I heard there's another Gracie, his name's Rickson.
Yeah, he's one of the older brothers.
Yeah, he's supposed to be better than Royce, who lost the last time, so.
Oh, Royce didn't lose.
Oh, yeah, what was it? He bowed out?
He bowed out because he was so badly battered.
Right.
He beat the other guy. Made the other guy subdue.
Uh-huh.
Submit, I mean.
Was that a pretty brutal battle?
Yeah, well, the other guy weighed 260 or so, and Royce only weighs about 175.
Uh-huh.
He takes on some pretty big dudes, and some of them are kind of clumsy, but this guy wasn't clumsy.
Mm-hmm.
And he damn near beat Royce, but Rickson's supposed to be older and better, but I don't see him in there doing any of the fighting.
He went over to Japan and won a tournament over there about 2 months ago.
I don't see him in the Ultimate Fighter.
I think he'll probably do it next time since Royce.
Yeah, he will. I'd like to see him do it.
Yeah. He's a lot more solid than Royce from the pictures I've seen of him.
A lot more what?
A lot more solid. He's got a little more meat to him.
He's bigger and stronger.
Yeah.
But I got the impression watching these fights that Royce or Hoyce, whatever you call it, in the first one.
Uh-huh.
And, you know why they pronounce it Royce Hoyce?
What's that?
They're Portuguese, and they have a different way of pronouncing certain letters. They don't speak Spanish, they speak Portuguese. In the country they're from, in South America, instead of Spanish, they speak Portuguese.
Uh-huh.
So that's why they pronounce ours like H's.
I see.
At any rate, Royce, I see him in the first Ultimate Fighter, and I see him in the second Ultimate Fighter, and he's going against some pretty big, strong guys, and he's getting kind of battered around. I see him in the third Ultimate Fighter, where he got battered so badly that he had to bow out.
Right.
In his next match, and I'm thinking, what the hell's the matter with these big brothers? It's almost like they're taking advantage of their kid brother, you know, they're pushing him in there and making him do all the work. You know what I mean?
Right. Well, maybe they want to show that the smallest one can, you know, go the farthest. I don't know.
Maybe that's it. I'll
pull his own, basically.
I almost feel like saying to him, hey, why don't you, kind of go easy on your kid brother. You're making him do everything.
Right. Well, I want to see,
I almost feel sorry for Hoyce, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I want to see Rory, and he's the guy who's made all the challenges. The guy with the mustache.
Yeah.
The oldest brother,
they're all bigger than Hoyce, you know, he's the small one.
Right. Anyway, getting back to, this isn't really about Bruce, but do you have any street stories of your students successfully implementing some of your grappling techniques?
Bruce is kind of a nice, likable guy. Royce, you know?
Yeah.
I heard him talk once or twice on TV, and he's not assuming. He doesn't brag or blow off.
Right.
And, it's like he's a real serious guy, and, he seems to be kind of a nice guy. I sort of liked him.
This was Royce?
Yeah.
Okay.
I kind of liked him. He doesn't seem to be a blowhard or, you know, swaggering or anything.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. What were you saying about my students?
Do you have any street stories about your students implementing some of your techniques at all?
Yeah, I've had several students get into situations where some of them were bouncers, and they'd write to me and tell me how a certain move I showed them worked so damn good, in spite of the fact that the guy was a lot bigger than they were, you know. And one of them phoned me, and he said, gee, that move works screeched over to a stop. As close as he could off to the side, but he stopped real fast, and cars kind of piled up behind him to keep from hitting him. And he jumped out of the truck and ran over to the guy, and said, what the hell are you doing with that? The dog, you know, the dog really looked pathetic.
Right.
And he was beating the dog with a stick, beating the hell out of it. And my friend ran over, and he's a real decent guy, and he can't stand stuff like that. And he said, what the hell are you doing to that dog? He said, what do you mean beating him with that stick like that? And the guy said, maybe I'll beat you with it. And he pulled the stick back, and my friend just jumped in and took him down with one punch and ripped the stick out of his hands. Then when the guy was down there cowering, he cracked him with the stick. He says, how do you like it? And the guy just kind of cowered. And he said he was a big dude, too. Big, tall, rangy guy. And then he took the stick and hurled it away somewhere. Now, you know what else happened there? He grabbed the dog. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Grabbed the dog and threw the dog in the truck with him.
Uh-huh.
And I think later on he gave the dog to somebody, but he wouldn't let the guy have it. I think everything he did was illegal there. He grabbed the dog and pulled it in the truck with him.
Right.
And the dog seemed pretty willing to go, and he drove off with him. But as he ran over and jumped in the truck with the dog, several people that had stopped to watch applauded. No kidding. They started clapping.
That was a lucky dog then, right?
Yeah, he said, well, that was kind of amazing that several people were clapping like that, you know.
Right.
They've seen what happened, see. And it was a lucky dog. But that's a couple of the things that happened, but one or two other things like that happened. But, Paul, what happens, the students get into a fight. So far, all they did was straight punch the guy and he went down. They didn't have to do anything else.
Right.
Just hit him once or twice, bam, 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 like that, and the guy's down, and they don't get back up. Now, if they'd run into a guy who was a hell of a tough street fighter, they might have to do more. But so far, every story that my students have told me wound up the same way.
What other students besides Jesse from the Seattle period do you keep in touch with?
Keep in touch with Skip Ellsworth and Leroy Garcia.
What about Tati Camaro?
Yeah, I've been to Tati's store once or twice and said hello.
Uh-huh.
And I got one of my students delivers to his store every day.
Okay. Yeah. He's got quite a school in the basement of his store, doesn't he?
Dad, did we forget something? Don't we forget.
It's Josh. Josh, can you say hi to Ed?
But no, what we forgot.
What we forget.
What's his name?
Joshua. Joshua Lee.
Kane.
Joshua Lee. Hey, this is Ed. How are you doing? I heard all about you.
He's smiling.
Sounds like a nice kid.
He's a good boy.
Josh, he's old, huh?
He's upstairs. We'll go get him after we're done. Would it be okay if I called you back a little later, Ed, to finish this? Gonna be home?
Well, I'm gonna be busy, but that's the reason I wanted to do it now, because you just happened to catch me right in between. But
we can try to finish it. I don't know how he's gonna be, but we'll try to finish it.
Well, yeah, you can call me back in 10 minutes or so, but
let's keep going while he's sitting on me here.
Okay.
Let's see.
I hope I'm giving you a decent interview.
Oh, everything's great. Much has been said about Bruce Lee's evolution in the martial arts. Have you seen the modifications he made over the years to form what the public has come to know as Jeet Kune Do?
What?
Have you seen the modifications over the years to form what has become, what we come to know as Jeet Kune Do?
Well, I've seen a lot of different people doing it, and they all do it differently.
Does it differ that much from what you learned from Bruce?
Yeah.
In what ways?
That's hard to explain. That's very difficult to explain. But it's not the same.
You think it's any more effective or less effective?
Oh, I don't want to get into that.
Okay. Let's see.
Paul, I just teach what I teach the best I can.
Right.
Try to be a good teacher, and I know that it works.
1968.
I was a timekeeper.
Timekeeper. Do you have any interesting details about the fight?
Jesse's book tells it all, you know.
Yeah, I've talked to Jesse about it. I didn't know if you had anything else to add about it at all.
Well, no, except that I was amazed. And when the guy was laying down on the floor there and we pulled him back and propped him up against the wall,
uh-huh.
He looked up and he says, I mean, his eyes opened, fluttered open, and he looked up at me. I was the timekeeper, and he says, how long do it take him to defeat me, you know?
Uh-huh.
He sort of half raised up when he asked the question, and I said, and it took 11 seconds, see?
Right.
I felt so damn sorry for the guy that I doubled it, you know? I said, 22 seconds.
Right.
And he said, oh, and he laid back down against the wall like he was utterly crushed. I thought that was, later on I thought about that, and I thought that was kind of pathetic but funny at the same time.
Right.
It was kind of pitiful, but it was also kind of comical.
After seeing this fight, did that kind of solidify your faith in what Bruce was teaching you?
Didn't have to? No. As a matter of fact, I wasn't a bit surprised by what he did.
Uh-huh.
At the time, I was so impressed by him and what he did there.
Yeah.
No, I just kind of took it for granted, which is something you should never do. But I mean, you know, I was so impressed by him. Shit, he could handle me so easily. And when he just went straight punching in on that guy, he just tore him apart.
Right.
I just sort of took it for granted.
Now, did you see Bruce much after he left Seattle? And can you recall the last time you had met with him?
Oh, the last time I saw Bruce, shit, I don't know. It was about 1963.
Uh-huh.
And then we moved down to Kent, which is about 40 miles from here. I had a job down there, and I was struggling to keep a family together and keep the money coming in. I almost lost contact with Jesse. For a couple of years, I only contacted Jesse every 3 or 4 months. Then we moved back to Seattle a couple of years later, and Bruce by that time was down in California. So I didn't see Bruce after the early part of 63.
Did you know Linda?
No.
Never met Linda?
Funny thing is, I never met Linda.
Uh-huh.
I think he met Linda right around the time that we moved down to Kent.
I see.
Met Linda, unfortunately. I met Linda at Bruce's funeral.
Oh.
I think I said hello, and that was about all.
No,
she sent me a nice note afterwards, a very nice thank you note for coming to the funeral.
Uh-huh.
Very nice woman.
What were your thoughts on the movies that Bruce made?
Oh, shit. For a while, I couldn't go to any movie that he made because I was too worried about I'd get upset.
Right.
So, because, I mean, you know, I mean, the guy died, and I didn't want to go to a movie he was in and see him like he was alive again. I was afraid it would make me very upset.
Yeah.
But when I finally did go to a movie with him in it, I handled it okay. You know, I didn't go there for 2 or 3 years. His movies were out for several years before I finally went to one.
Did you see any underlying principles in your training that Bruce included in some of his fight scenes, possibly?
Yeah, a flash here and a flicker there, but I mean, most of it was for the public.
Right. Did you ever see the movie Dragon? Do you have an opinion of it?
Dragon? Which one's that?
That was Dragon, the Bruce Lee story.
Oh, yeah, I got it here on videotape. One of my students gave it to me.
What did you think of that?
Nothing?
Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
All right. You know, there's a lot of stuff been put out about it. Dragon is the fiction show about Bruce, right? It wasn't a documentary.
Right. It was the movie with Jason Scott Lee.
Yeah, that's... It was as inaccurate as hell, Paul.
Crap. Yeah. Have you
puts it off, but if you see a documentary, they do.
Yeah. I could tell a lot of those guys were, I've been following Bruce's life, for the past 10 years. And what people said maybe 5 years ago, they'll change their stories now, just because they're on a video or whatever.
Yeah, well, it's all crap.
But
I don't, tell you the truth, I don't talk about Bruce much.
Mm-hmm.
I hardly ever mention him.
What's the reason for that?
Well, there's no point.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing to talk about. I just teach Kung Fu, and I teach it as well as I can. I teach Kung Fu and supplemental stuff, and there's no particular occasion to mention Bruce.
Right.
I know a hell of a lot of people use his name often loosely. They throw it around constantly.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
That's ridiculous.
Do you have any plans to release any more videos in the future? Possibly write a book?
I've had people ask me to do another video, and I might. I don't know. I got a grill student who's pretty damn good. She'd ask me to do another video, and I might. I don't know. I got a grill student who's pretty damn good, and she wants me to do a video and get her in it.
Hello?
Yeah, she asked me if I would do it, and I said, maybe I will.
Uh-huh.
I don't have any plans on anything, though, right now. I'm just teaching, and if I do a video, I'll let you know. If I do a book, I'll let you know. Incidentally, what's your...